Hello everyone, this is Mirzai from Cal Poly Pomona, and in this lesson we are going to learn how to solve a linear programming problem using the graphical method. We usually use the graphical method for problems with two decision variables. The reason that we do not use the graphical method for problems with more than two decision variables is the complexity of their visual representation. Now, for problems with more than two decision variables, we later introduce the simplex method. Now, let's look at one example to see how the graphical method works. Suppose we have a maximization problem subject to a set of constraints. Now, to solve this problem graphically, we need to implement two steps. The first step is to draw the constraints, and the second step is to draw the objective function. In an optimization problem, when we draw the constraints of the problem, we form an area which is called feasible area or feasible region. The ultimate goal for an optimization problem is to find the best value of the objective function within that feasible area. Now, if you look at the constraints that are given in this problem, you see that they are all in forms of inequalities. The area that is given by an inequality usually includes the line that forms the inequality and the points in one side of that inequality. Now, to deal with this condition and find the feasible area given by an inequality, we first assume that each inequality is in fact an equation which represents a line. Now, to draw a line in a two-dimensional space, we need two points. We usually find these two points by one setting x1 equal to 0 and one setting x2 equal to 0. For this line, if I put x1 equal to 0, then x2 will be equal to 100. And if I put x2 equal to 0, then x1 will be equal to 50. Now, having these two points, I'm able to draw a line represented by these two points. Okay, if I find the two points and then connect the two points that are given here, I'm able to draw this line. Now, to check what side of this line I'm looking at in this inequality, one way is to pick an arbitrary point which is not on the line and see if satisfies the inequality or not. If it does, we are looking at the side that includes the point, otherwise we are looking at the opposite side. By standard, we usually select the point 0 and 0 if it's not on the line. And in this example, if I select point 0 and 0, which is the center of the coordinate here, now if I put this point in the first constraint and replace x1 and x2 by 0, you see that 0 is less than 100, so the constraint is satisfied. So we are looking at the side that includes the point 0 and 0. We can show this conclusion with an arrow on the line. Now, if I draw the second line of this problem, again, by setting x1 and x2 equal to 0, I'm able to find two points where if I connect these two points, I can get the second constraint line. Now, to decide what side of this line we are looking at in this inequality, again, we can replace the points 0 and 0 in the second constraint and check whether the condition is satisfied or not. By replacing 0 and 0, the condition is true. So we are looking at the side that includes 0 and 0. Remember to name your constraint as you move forward, because later on we might be interested in finding the intersection of lines, and it makes your life easier to know what lines you're looking at, or what is the line equation that you need to pick to find the intersection point. Now, the last constraint is x1 less than or equal to 40. And for this line, it's enough to find one point, which is 40 and 0. And we are looking at the side that includes the point 0 and 0. Because if we put x1 equal to 0, 0 is less than 40, and the condition is satisfied in this constraint. Now we are done with drawing our constraints, we can form the feasible region, which is in fact the intersection of all the areas found by constraints. The intersection of all these feasible areas will be the area that is shown by yellow in this example. Now that we are done with finding the feasible area, we are interested to find the x1 and x2 in this area that maximizes the value of objective function, which is 3x1 plus 2x2. And this is the meaning of optimization. We have a feasible area, we have a lot of alternative for x1 and x2. Any points in this region is a feasible solution to our constraints. Now we want to find the combination of x1 and x2 that maximizes this function here. To be able to find the point that maximizes this function, we start by putting the objective function equal to some arbitrary number. This arbitrary number is 60. You can put this function equal to any number that you would like. But in this example, I selected 60. The next step is to draw this line. Again, by setting x1 and x2 equal to 0, we can find two points. And by connecting these two points, we are able to draw the objective function line. Please note that the value of objective function for all the x1 and x2 on this line will be equal to 60. So any single points on this line have the same objective function, which is z equal to 60. Now that we draw the objective function line, we need to repeat this step again, but this time we set objective function equal to a different number. Defining the new number is dependent to the objective function direction. By direction, I mean whether we are looking at a maximization or a minimization objective function. If you are looking at the maximization problem, the second point or the second value that you select for your objective function should be greater than the initial points that you have selected. Since in the first try I selected 60 and I'm looking at a maximization problem, my second value should be greater than 60. So for a maximization problem, the next value must be greater than the initial value of 60 that I selected. But if I was looking at a minimization problem, the second value or the next value that I select for my objective function should be lower than 60. Something like 40 should be my choice for a minimization problem. So remember, for a maximization problem, the next value always greater than the initial value. And for minimization problem, the next value always less than the initial value. Now, the next value that I selected in this example is 120. Now, I need to draw this line as well. So, I select two points by setting x1 and x2 equal to 0. And if I connect these two points, I get the line for z equal to 120. Again, note that all the points on this line have the same objective function of 120. The two lines z equal to 60 and z equal to 120 are parallel lines. And as we increase the objective function, we are moving toward the right-hand side of this plane. As you see, if we move the objective function line to the right-hand side, parallelly to the initial objective function line, its value will increase. This shows the direction of improvement for the objective function. According to a theorem, in a convex set, the optimal solution happens at the last corner of the feasible area that objective function line hits as it's moving toward its improvement. Improvement in a minimization problem means a reduction in the objective function, and for a maximization, it means an increase in the objective function. Since we are looking at a maximization problem, improving the objective function is synonym to an increase to its value. As you see in this example, the last corner point that the objective function hits as it's moving the feasible area is this point. So the optimal solution is at the intersection of constraints 1 and 2. Now we have to find the intersection of these two points. By solving the equations for the intersection, we'll find x1 equal to 20 and x2 equal to 60 is the optimal point for this problem. Now we have to find the value of objective function for the optimal solution. By replacing x1 and x2 in the objective function, we get the value of z equal to 180, which shows the optimal solution to this problem. Sometimes there is no feasible solution for a linear programming problem. In this part, we take a look at an example of an infeasible LP. Suppose we have a maximization problem as shown on the screen. Now let's draw the constraint and form the feasible area for this problem. For the first constraints, if we set x1 and x2 equal to 0, we are able to find two different points where if we connect the two points, we find the first constraint of the problem. To decide what side of this line we are looking at, we need to replace the point 0 and 0 in the first constraint. Since the first constraint is satisfied with this point, we are looking at the side that contains the value of 0 and 0, which is this side. Now, if I look at the second constraint, which is x2 greater than or equal to 3, and this line represents the second constraint, and we are looking at the side that doesn't include 0, because 0 doesn't satisfy this constraint. Now, to form the feasible area of the problem, I need to find the intersection of these two areas. Since both x1 and x2 are positive, we are in the first quarter of the system of coordinates, and there is no intersection for these two areas in this quarter. Therefore, there is no feasible area, so the LP doesn't have a feasible answer.